So when you're working with your Cisco switches, you know that you can start with a base configuration. This is something that we're gonna do when we're configuring a production Cisco switch. This is something that we're gonna wanna do when we're configuring a Cisco switch that's in our practice lab as we're gearing up for some certification exam. In this video, I'm gonna share with you an awesome initial base configuration for your Cisco switch that we're gonna build together. I'm Anthony Sequeira with ITProTV. So let's take a look at what that awesome Cisco switch base config would look like. And by the way, I will be sure to put together an episode for you where we do a router base config, but it's not going to be that different. So a lot of these configuration parameters are going to be just like we would do on the router. Now, notice that we have this banner message from Cisco here, and a banner message is most likely going to be a requirement on your Cisco switch. If I do a show running configuration on this device, and in order to see the running configuration, we need to get into privilege mode, of course. If I do a show running configuration on this device, you'll see what Cisco has done. They have gone in here and they have done an exec banner message, an incoming banner message, a login banner message, and all of those have the exact same text. What they're doing is ensuring that this banner message, which contains important copyright information and legal information, is always displayed no matter how the user accesses the device. And this is a great practice. We'll want to do the same thing. We'll want to get with our legal team and make sure we use the appropriate language about if you're not authorized, stay out of this device. There's a famous story in information technology. I never did go and vet whether or not it was true, but it sure is a fun story, that there was this computer criminal once that could not be prosecuted because the Windows server that he attacked was welcoming him to Windows. So, hey, welcome to Windows, and that allowed him to do all this nefarious activity, and the company couldn't prosecute him because, after all, he was welcomed into the device. We want to definitely not welcome them into the operating system of the Cisco switch. We want to tell them we will prosecute them to the full extent of the law. So have your legal team help you with these banner messages and display them, as you can see is done here. Now, one of the things we need to do right away is get into global configuration mode here, and we need to give this name a switch, because a switch doesn't want a name of just switch. That's so boring. And it doesn't identify that device uniquely for us, unlike a topology map. So we'll give this a name of ITProTVSW1. And you'll want a naming convention that you're going to use in your base configurations, as well as those configurations that are rolled into production. So the first thing that I like to do is work on the base configuration of the console. This is so important to us because it's going to impact how we work with this device. And one of the very first things we want to do is make sure that we enable synchronous logging so that the CLI is not driving us insane by interrupting our typing, having it carry down to the next row and all that crazy stuff as we are making our configurations. The other thing that we're going to do on lab-based configurations is we're going to go in and set the exec timeout to 0:0. Now, in production, you would want the timeout to be pretty aggressive, like maybe even 2 minutes with your minute and second values that you can set here, so that if you walk away from the production switch, someone can't walk up behind you and start wreaking havoc. In a lab environment, a best practice is to eliminate the timeout behavior, as I've done here with the 0:0 setting. Makes great sense. In a lab environment, you're going to often open a book or watch an ITProTV episode as you're studying, and you don't want it timing out while you're doing that. So that's it for the console. Now, what we're going to do is back out of the console And let's talk about the virtual terminals. So we're going to go line VTY 0 space 4. And let me do that correctly. It's 0 space 4 in order to enter those lines. And in here, it's often the case, even in the lab these days, where we're going to say the appropriate way to access this device remotely is going to be to use secure shell. So we use the command transport input SSH to limit incoming connections over those virtual terminal lines to just the secure shell protocol. Sorry, Telnet, you're clear text and you're bad. So no Telnet is permitted in that configuration. So now I'm going to exit and let's do this. Let's do show VLAN brief. And what we're going to see on this device is that we have all of the ports that would be available on this device going into VLAN 1. That's the default VLAN, and that is an untagged VLAN. There are some security issues that could result with that VLAN, so we really don't want to use it in most environments. So what you'll end up doing in your base configuration is you will create a VLAN that you can identify at a glance, like 999 is a number that might stick out. And you can take those unused ports that you're not using and you can get them out of that VLAN. So I'll say exit from the VLAN. And then I will say interface gigabit 0/2, for example, and I will say switch port mode access, switch port access VLAN 999. So we will take this and put it in this VLAN that we don't plan on using. And by the way, we'll also issue the shutdown command, which I've abbreviated here as shut, of course, so that that interface is not enabled. So now when I do my show VLAN brief, we see that we have this VLAN 999 that has any ports that we're not going to be using. Those ports are in the shutdown state. And that is a great way to go with your base configuration for security purposes and some other purposes as well, like overall resource utilization on the device. Why have interfaces up that you're not using? So notice we have now gigabit 0/0 and 0/1. They're active, they're in VLAN 1, and obviously you would then go in and use global configuration mode and then interface configuration mode to give them the parameters that they need in your production environment or even your lab environment. Maybe it's VLAN 100 that both of those are going to participate in, or maybe those ports are going to be trunk ports, so you would do that trunking configuration at this point. The last thing that you want to consider is your passwords into the device. So these days, it's often the case that we're going to go in and we're going to say enable secret, and we're going to set a super strong password, and you won't do Cisco like I just did. No longer do we worry about the old enable password for backwards compatibility, because there's very difficult to find these days a Cisco device that would actually need that unencrypted clear text old enable password. So the enable secret is going to be what we use today. So we have taken a look at the Cisco base configuration that really incorporates some best practices and some features that are not only going to be convenient for you, like the logging synchronous and the exec timeout, but can also be critical in production environments where security is a concern. My name is Anthony Sequeira with ITProTV, and now you know what the pros know.